Hello students, welcome to Unacademy, India's largest learning platform. I am Abhishek Datta. I did my graduation from IIT Roorkee and my MBA from Ahmedabad. So in the previous video, we were discussing about the two subatomic particles, which is neutron and proton. In this video, we'll be starting off with a very important topic, which are the different atomic models. We'll be discussing two of such atomic models and discussing them in detail. So let's begin this. Hello students, welcome to Unacademy once again. This video is about the atomic models. This is an important aspect of chemistry and this is part 1 of the video. Do look out for the part 2 after this. I am Abhishek Datta. You already know about me, so let's begin the video. We'll be taking up two atomic models. There are more than that. We'll be discussing it in part 2. Firstly, we'll discuss about the Thomson's model, which is a very simple concept. And secondly, we'll discuss about Rutherford's gold scattering experiment as well as the conclusions which we drew and finally arrived at the nuclear model of an atom. So let's begin the video with the first topic, which is the Thomson's model. Now, what is the atomic model which was discussed by Mr. J.J. Thomson? So Mr. J.J. Thomson, in 1898, he proposed that an atom possesses a spherical shape, right? It is a spherical shape with a radius of approximately 10 to the power minus 10 meters, in which what happens is the positive and the negative charges, both of them are uniformly distributed. So you can see this figure over here. It's a spherical shape, right? And there are both positive and negative charges which are uniformly distributed over here. So you can see the distribution in this case, that the positive and negative charges are close by each other and it is uniformly distributed. The electrons are embedded into it in such a manner so as to give the most stable electrostatic arrangement. Definitely there will be some attraction between the opposite charges, which is the positive and the negative charges, and there will be repulsion between the same charges. Okay, so that is why it will attain the most stable electrostatic arrangement after some time and go into equilibrium. This is what Mr. J.J. Thomson had proposed, and many different names were given to this model. For example, the plum pudding model or the raisin pudding or the watermelon model, because of the resemblance with a plum or a raisin in a pudding or the seeds in a watermelon, right? So an important feature of this model is that the mass of the atom, now we are talking about the mass, right? So the mass of the atom is coming from the positive elements over here, which is the protons, because as we saw in the previous video, the electrons have very negligible mass. So the positive protons, they give mass to the electron, and because they are uniformly distributed, and hence it is assumed that the mass is uniformly distributed over the whole of the atom, right? This is an important conclusion which comes from this model. Let's move on, guys. So as we know, it has some limitations. The current model which you must have studied in the previous classes is not this, right? It's the next model which you have studied. So definitely it must have had some limitations. So what are the limitations of this Thomson's atomic model? So although this model was able to explain the overall neutrality of the atom, atoms were neutral in nature. They did not have any positive or negative charge as a whole. Only the electrons and the protons had charges and they nullified each other, and that is how the atom was neutral in charge, but was not consistent with the results of the later experiments. For example, the Rutherford experiment, which is the gold foil scattering experiment carried out by Mr. Rutherford. So if you see the experiment, which we'll see in the next slide, you can conclude that this model does not explain the observations which were seen in this experiment, right? So Thomson was awarded the Nobel Prize for Physics in 1906 for his theoretical and experimental investigations on the conduction of electricity by gases, right? And this model played an important role in this research office. Okay guys, so this was the Thomson's atomic model. It's a very simple model with positive and negative charges uniformly distributed over a sphere, but it had some limitations of its own, right guys? So let's move on to the next model now, which is the Rutherford's nuclear model of atom, right? So he conducted some experiments over here. The name of the experiment is gold foil scattering experiment conducted by Mr. Rutherford. So what is the experiment? This is the apparatus of the experiment which he used. In 1910, Rutherford carried out the experiment in which thin sheet of gold foil was bombarded with a beam of alpha particles. So you can see the thin sheet of gold foil which he used over here, and there was a source of alpha particles which is kept over here, and there is some plate so that it moves in a straight direction, and we are directly hitting the gold plate. It's a very thin gold plate over here with the alpha atoms, and this is the source of alpha atoms, right? We are hitting the gold plate with alpha atoms. Now if you minutely see this gold plate over here, I have expanded this view. So this is the microscopic level. So this is the sheet of iron. This is the cross section of the sheet of the iron, and the atoms, the alpha particles, sorry, are hitting the gold particles in this manner. Okay, so this is the beam of alpha particles which is hitting the thin gold foil. So what is happening is the results of the scattering experiment were quite unexpected. So what would you expect, guys? You know that the atom is like this because J.J. Thomson has given his atomic model, and this is what was prevalent during that time, and hence even Rutherford thought this must be true, and hence we went forward with this atomic model. But according to this model, what would have happened is most of the alpha particles should have gone through this particle, through the atom, right? Because most of the space is empty, and because it's uniformly distributed, there shouldn't have been any deflection. But as you can see in this case, there was quite a few number of deflections. So there was a ring kept around here, which was a photographic plate, right guys? And this could detect the presence of any particle which was hitting it. So Mr. Rutherford over here, he observed a lot of particles being deflected from the gold plate and hitting this photographic plate, sorry, right? So a lot of deflections were happening, but these were the expectations from us because Mr. Thomson has given us this model to us, and there was quite a number of empty space between the particles over here, right? So according to the Thomson model of atom, the mass of each gold atom in the foil should have been spread evenly, right, over the entire atom. This is what Mr. Thomson had told us until now. And alpha particles had enough energy to pass directly through such a uniform distribution of matter. These were high speed alpha particles, guys, and hence the expectation was that most of them would pass through the gold atom, right? It was expected that the particles would slow down and change directions by small angles as they passed through the foil. Only small deviations, very minute deviations, would have occurred. This was the expectation. And most of the alpha particles must have passed through the atom over here, the gold atom over here. This was the expectation. But as you can see, the observations were totally different. So let us look at what were the observations now. So this is the same diagram I've reproduced for your reference over here. So the first observation is that most of the alpha particles, they pass through the gold foil undetected, right? So most of them pass through, guys. And there were no deflection for the alpha particles beam. A small fraction of the alpha particles were deflected by small angles, right? A small fraction of them were deflected. This shouldn't have occurred had JJ given us the right model. So that was not the right model. So this is the first observation which says a very few alpha particles, 1 in 20,000, bounced back. They totally bounced back 180 degrees. That is, they were deflected by nearly 180 degree. It took a U-turn. It hit the alpha beam. The alpha particle had hit something very hard, and it took a U-turn from that. This was totally unexpected by Mr. Rutherford. He had assumed that JJ model of atomic model was totally right, and this shouldn't have occurred had that model been totally right. So these were some of the observations, right guys? So Mr. Rutherford over here, he made his own model now because he knew there was something fishy going on. He gave his own conclusions and he arrived at a totally different model. That model is the nuclear model of atom which you are studying in this section, right guys? So what were the conclusions given by Mr. Rutherford? Let us see them now. So most of the space in the atom is empty. That is true, as given by J.J. Thomson as well, as most of the alpha particles pass through the foil undeflected. So as we saw in the previous observations part, the first observation was that most of the alpha particles, they pass through the gold foil undeflected, right? So this led to the first conclusion that the most of the space in the atom is empty. Okay guys, let us look at the second conclusion now. A few of the positively charged alpha particles were deflected. This was the second observation which we saw in the previous slide. The deflection must be due to enormous repulsive force, showing that the positive charge of the atom is not spread throughout the atom as Thomson had presumed. So this is where Rutherford has given his own thoughts. So that is why he concluded that the positive charge has to be concentrated in a very small volume that repelled and reflected the positively charged alpha particles. So he said the positive charge which was present in the gold atom over here, it cannot be uniformly distributed. It has to be present in a very small amount because alpha particles are positively charged and it got repelled back by the gold atom, right guys? This could have been possible only when the repulsion was so high that it took a U-turn totally. So this could have been possible only because the positive charge had to be concentrated in a very small volume. And he named this small volume over here by the name nucleus, as we'll see in the next slide. So calculations by Rutherford showed that the volume occupied by the nucleus is negligible small as compared to the total volume of the atom. As we saw, most of the space was empty. So the nucleus took a very small amount of space when compared to the total atom, and most of the space was empty, and that empty space was taken up by the electrons. The radius of the atom is about 10 to the power minus 10 meters. Please remember this ratio, guys, while that of the nucleus is 10 to the power minus 15. So the nucleus and the total radius of the atom, that is of the power 10 to the power 5, which is a very huge number, which means that the nucleus is really very, 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 very small as compared to the size of the atom. So these were the conclusions which Mr. Rutherford has given us. Let's look at the Rutherford's model now, what he gave us at the final model. So this was the expected results, right? So he expected that most of the atoms to pass through, but most of the atoms did not pass through. Actually, most of them did. A few of them even deflected back and took U-turn as well. So these were the actual results. And this was the JJ model, JJ Thomson model. And this is the Rutherford model now. Okay, guys, so you can see the positively charged protons over here in the center, which take a very little amount of space. This is called the name nucleus. So Mr. Rutherford, the first point in his nuclear model of atom, it says the positive charge and most of the mass of the atom, right? So the positive charge as well as the most of the mass of the atom once densely concentrated in extremely small region. This very small portion of the atom was called nucleus by Mr. Rutherford. Secondly, he said that the nucleus is surrounded by electrons, as you can see in this diagram. The nucleus is surrounded by electrons that move around the nucleus with very high speed in circular paths. They are called by the name orbits. So the electrons move around the central nucleus, and they move around in very high speed, right guys? And they are moving in circular paths by the name orbits. He also said electrons and the nucleus are held together by electrostatic forces of attraction, because opposite charges, they attract each other, right guys? So this was the Rutherford's nuclear model of atom. Let's summarize, guys, what all we studied. We studied about the two atomic models. The first one is a very basic model, Thomson model, which was also known by the name plum pudding model. So he said all the atoms are made up of spherical shape, in which the positive and the negative charge, they are uniformly distributed. The mass of the atom is assumed to be uniformly distributed, right guys? Because of the uniform distribution of the positive and the negative charges. But Mr. Rutherford over here, he carried out a few experiments, and he said that this Thomson's model was totally wrong, and this is the correct model, and this was the Rutherford's model given by Mr. Rutherford. So according to this model, the positive charge and the most of the mass of the atom was densely concentrated in the nucleus, the central region, and electrons moved around the nucleus. You can see the negative signs around the nucleus, right? With very high speed in circular paths called orbits, and they are held together by the electrostatic forces. So this was the Rutherford's model and the Thomson model in this video. Thank you guys for listening to me. In the next session, we'll be taking up isobars and isotopes. This is again a very important topic. And as well as we'll see, there were some drawbacks to the Rutherford's model as well. And we'll look at how the next models were developed. As always, if you enjoy watching my videos, you can always follow me over here and ask me any doubts if you have in the comment section. Thank you guys. Take care. Bye-bye.